To our prosperity. Mm. To our good health and happiness. Mm. And most important of all, well, to life, l'chaim.
L'chaim, l'chaim,
to life. Here's to the father I've tried to be.
Here's to my bride to be.
Bring l'chaim to life.
It, in the beginning, it was not called Jewish theater. It was called Yiddish theater. Yeah. Because almost all of us were either immigrants or children of immigrants, and Yiddish was the primary language spoken at home. And therefore, Yiddish theater was very much a staple in Jewish, Yiddish-speaking households.
So I actually got my first gig at the Volksbühne, the National Yiddish Theater Volksbühne, right after my senior year of college. So Sam Kamelhar, who I think graduated a year or two after me, was doing, I think, an internship or something, and they had a stage manager drop out last minute for a reading. And it was like 2 days before I was supposed to leave for Maine to do a season of summer stock there. So I did this reading with them, and they really liked me, so they asked me to come and be the ASM for Die Goldene Kalle, which is the Golden Bride, that winter. So I didn't intentionally pursue Yiddish theater, but it was something that kind of pursued me in the way that I think the Volksbühne, whenever they talk about the community that they have, they always refer to it as mishpocha. It's always about family, and I think when they find someone who fits in with them or who has similar values, they kind of grab you. And even over the years of the work I've done there, I've worked with many similar actors. So the Yiddish theater kind of found me more than me finding the Yiddish theater.
And my experience began when I was, I would call it a baby. My mother used to take me to the Yiddish stage, which at that time here was located in the East Village. And the East Village was sort of like a suburb of the Lower East Side where all the Jews came off the ships. And we saw many, many Yiddish plays, musicals, and comedy was a big thing. Coming out of the war, especially, people craved to have comedy.
Return to Broadway with great performances for a spotlight on musicals then and now. All of them different, and yet with one thing in common.
Jews.
The Jewish heritage of the composers and lyricists who created that special brand of American optimism.
The quintessential Broadway musical.
And so much more.
The idea of outsiders overcoming obstacles.
Look for Broadway Musicals, A Jewish Legacy.
Tradition.
On Great Performances.
But when you say what is Jewish, it people, even if they live in some rural place in who knows where, they understand somewhat that Judaism is a living, breathing religion.
I think if the source is, you know, based upon history, if it's influenced in any way by culture, that can definitely have an impact on what a play or a musical is labeled as, even though Jewish or not, or like you said, Christian or not. You know, just this kind of the culture, the history, family, personal stories, experiences.
In like experiencing the texts and the stories, I don't think I've ever done a show at the Volksbühne that didn't have a Shabbat scene, that didn't have a Sabbath scene, no matter what it was. And there was kind of a lore of like, I think there is in Orthodox traditions, you're not allowed to watch theater, and that including a Sabbath scene makes it okay because then it's kind of like a religious service. I don't know how true that is, but that was certainly the myth backstage.
It's not about, oh, a character's name is Jewish or like one family in a play is Jewish. It's about like the foundation, the story, the music. Like, yes, the characters, but what drives the characters, their culture, their food, language, all of that.
Jewish religion, Jewish life, Jewish custom, Jewish culture, Jewish tradition, because not everybody who's Jewish is necessarily observant in sort of, you know, Torah and Bible, but they may have a lot of cultural aspects to their upbringing. So things Jewish have a large spectrum surrounding it.
I think Jewish theater is popular outside of just the group you're in. A few years ago on Broadway, it's a comedy, and I'm not sure, I've never seen it, but I know it was kind of a parody, but also kind of like a love letter. There's Bad Jews. There's also the Yiddish production of Fiddler on the Roof that was off Broadway just last year. That would extend it a few times. Joel Grey directed. It was extended a few times, and it was a pretty long run, especially for an off-Broadway show and for a show entirely in Yiddish.
The Volksbühne makes a point that they want to bring Yiddish to everyone. They don't just cast actors who have had experience in using the Yiddish language for a performance. They don't just cast actors who are Jewish or actors who are white. They really believe in Yiddish theater being the theater of the people. That's what Volksbühne means. And that really is something that speaks to me.
For starters, it can't be as popular in any manner, because Jewish theater, or Yiddish theater, I should say again, okay, really was the immigrant experience. It was the immigrant experience. They came here, they spoke their language, and they created theater, because Jews are well known for theater throughout the ages. So it was a big thing. And we had probably about 10 theaters on the East Side, the Lower East Side, the East Village, those areas. And some moved uptown, actually, more, you know, like for those who are more affluent up in Harlem, where there is a lot of Jewish population. So it can't be the same. But I'm very gratified to see that schools are offering Yiddish as for coursework.
I know a lot of people, you know, that didn't necessarily know Yiddish, they went to the show just because they knew the story, they love the story, they were curious, they wanted to surround themselves and immerse themselves in that culture, and just kind of learn. And I think it goes for all art, you know? It's not just Jewish theater or like Christian theater. There are several shows or, you know, pieces of work that have been different languages or different cultures, or you don't necessarily know. You go to it knowing nothing, but you know, it's what you take when you leave, what you take with you, what you get out of the work, what you get out of the art. That's what I think people go back for time again and again.
It's hard to be Jewish, it's hard to be Jewish, it's hard to be Jewish in Russia. Yo, it's hard to be Jewish, it's hard to be Jewish, hard to be Jewish in Russia. Yo, bagels and lox, diamond shops, it's hard to be Jewish in Russia. Yo, hard to be Jewish, hard to be Jewish, hard to be Jewish in Russia. Yo, someone drop an Old Testament beat. Dreidels.
I think like Fiddler on the Roof, it has the very like pronounced Jewish like melodies, like obviously the language in a lot of the songs. The, you know, main family is Jewish, of course, and just the overall story, I think, with the music led to its popularity. I think if it were just were like a spoken play, no word, you know, like just words, no music, it wouldn't have that big of an impact as it does.
I have seen very little Jewish theater from the outside because of so much of what I've done has been in kind of the most popular Jewish theater in New York City. But I think being inside the culture of it, I think that there is a real acknowledgement of the struggles that the Jewish people have been through, and also the connection of that to the struggles of various communities that surround us in New York City. And I think that that it has become popular because of the tenacity of these people to want to continue to tell their story, to want to continue and commit to telling stories that aren't just the very popular Christian white stories that are happening. Yeah.
Well, I think just overall, the story and the message and the theme of the show resonates with a lot of different people and like generations, obviously. It's kind of like a timeless classic or just a timeless, you know, lesson to learn. And everyone can relate to the characters. But also, I think the especially the original production being so focused and driven by, you know, Jewish culture and stories and people, I'm not sure how, you know, popular that was in the 60s or like when the time when the show came out on Broadway. I'm not sure how many other shows did that. I mean, I said, I'm sure, you know, like, you know, there were people on Broadway and in the industry who came from Jewish backgrounds and families, but the stories itself in the show and the story on stage, I'm not sure how, you know, how many other shows did that. So I think that's something that really kind of was the driving force, one of the driving forces behind how popular the show became and how significant in culture and pop culture.
I grew up with the Yiddish stage. But that causes you to evolve into a lover of theater in itself. So it swells into the love of theater and drama and performance. And, you know, it's an extension into bigger things later on as you become, of course, consumed by America.
I think that there was a point in time where it was really seen as this Jewish story and all about the Jewish tradition. And I think, I don't know if you saw Fiddler, but what Joel did was he really pared down the story. And there were even times where they did events related to immigration and having, there was one time they like sold out the entire house to audience members who were immigrants who wouldn't normally have been able to see the show. And I think, for us, there was certainly that lens, especially in politically what was going on, about it not just being a Jewish story, about it being a story of people coming to America. And I think that was really poignant at the time and still is poignant at the time. And I think that that will continue as long as people choose to perform Fiddler. You know, there are things about sexism in Fiddler and about the way that a father treats his daughters. There's things about immigration, you know, there's things about classism and Tevye being poor. You know, I think that there are so many themes. It's about which ones you choose to draw to the surface, what you make important.
That's what we do. That's how we analyze. If you know how the people who study Torah, all the scholars, that's what they do. They break it down to every little word. What does that mean? I don't think so. Maybe it is. Maybe it's not. You'll never see a non-Jewish comment talk about socks.
Well, I haven't really seen like old Jewish plays, but I would assume there's like a big difference. I think like new Jewish plays, even like movies, more so like are used to like raise awareness on certain topics too, like the Holocaust, things like that, or just like Israel or like Judaism as a whole. And like older Jewish plays, you know, like you would think of like families going out to like theater, and it was more not as like a learning experience, but just more of like the everyday like Jewish family would go, and they would be like, oh, that's like me, like, you know, that's like my cousin, kind of a thing.
And it's the same with being Jewish. You don't have to say this is about the Jewish experience. You just get it.
For me, it's a different energy. It's a lot of times, even in doing a theater at the Volksbühne, even doing theater at the Yiddish, we have a lot of people who aren't Jewish. And there's always, it's never the Jewish people and the non-Jewish people. It is always the Jewish people who are so soaked in the ritual of what Judaism is, always inviting people in to participate in those rituals, to learn about traditions and to learn about that kind of energy and tenacity. And I think that I've watched that be conveyed to an audience. Like I've watched the open arms of our cast in Fiddler, when they all hold hands and they walk out singing Traditia, and that energy that they have of trying to accept each other and learn about each other and love each other. And I think that I've literally watched that go out into the audience, you know. And I think from hearing what people said about our show coming backstage or, you know, reviews, but really the people themselves, is that the feeling of that energy. That's the difference.
There's a saying in Yiddish, and I'm going to try to translate it. First, let me say it in Yiddish. Das Pintele Yid, the little bitty Jew. That's the literal translation. But the symbolic translation is that inside of every Jew is a little Jew running around with all the values and the traditions. And it might not come out much, but have you ever seen a Christian person say, there's something a little different about you? They have no idea that you're Jewish by religion, but that's not unusual to hear a Christian person say, you know, something different about you. I don't know if anybody ever said that to you.